Hi, I'm Amanda and you're watching Swell Entertainment. So, you wanted a video intro. I finished watching The Umbrella Academy in 2 days. It would have been faster had I not had school and work, and even then, I debated skipping both. Upon finishing The Umbrella Academy, I immediately took to Twitter to tweet at Netflix for seasons 2 through 5 like an asshole. I am obsessed and I loved almost every minute of it. And I may have an issue with becoming easily obsessed over things, but I will always find something within said things to complain about. So, I've seen a lot of opinions about the different characters within The Umbrella Academy, and some I agree with, some I don't. So this video is going to be me going through some of the main characters and defending but also complaining about them at the same time. You know, wholesome fun for the whole family. I'm just gonna go in order. Number one, Luther. I have mixed feelings about this big boy. And yes, I'm calling him big boy because that's what he acts like, a giant child. I've seen a lot of people just straight up slam dunking on Luther throughout the entire first season, and a lot of it I do agree with, but I think there's something that a lot of people also kind of overlook, and it's the fact that Luther, like all of his siblings, were in fact abused by Reginald. Manipulation and isolation are in fact types of abuse. And I don't want to see any of you in the comments going like, oh, Vanya and Klaus had it worse. This isn't a contest. Everyone can have trauma from a situation and everyone's going to reflect it in different ways. I fully agree that Luther handled a lot of things horribly throughout this season, but a lot of his actions can be linked to Reginald making it so Luther's whole identity was about being his father's number one. Even when he was the only one left in the academy, that's still how his father referred to him. And yeah, it doesn't justify everything, but it can explain some of it. Yes, I too found Luther and Allison's dynamic unsettling as hell. However, in defense of Luther and Allison, though they are referred to as siblings and they were all raised under the same roof and they all referred to Reginald as dad and they referred to Grace as mom, it does seem like they were more or less raised as just children in a boarding school. Again, let's bring back the isolation. It doesn't seem like they were allowed outside of the academy unless it was for missions, public appearances, or when they snuck out. That doesn't really do well when you're in your developmental years and you're supposed to be branching out to meet other people and make friends and develop your dynamics with other humans. It does make sense that the kids would start looking into each other. Still weird, but it's a little bit more understandable. Also, in Luther's defense, unlike his siblings who all left after Ben passed away, Luther never left the house. He stayed in the house, isolated from everyone, even isolated from his father when you look at it, and then after his accident, he was shipped off to the moon for 4 years, literally completely alone. Unlike his siblings who left and met other people and developed other relationships outside of the academy, he never left that bubble, and so he never developed some of the social cues and the social norms that others would. Emotional and mental maturity is severely stunted, even compared to his siblings, who, everything considered, all have a lot of baggage to unpack. Still weird and does not justify him putting Allison on a pedestal above all of his other siblings, but in the context of everything, it does kind of make sense. Also, I'm not familiar with the comics, but apparently Diego was like in love with Vanya or something, so there's that. Overall, Luther has gotten the most criticism for his treatment of Vanya in the last 2 episodes, and yes, I completely agree that his actions were ridiculous. If he could have shown just even like a sliver of empathy towards Vanya, the apocalypse at the very least would have been postponed. However, it does fit a bit more when you realize that Luther had just gotten his world rocked by realizing that his father literally sent him on a mission to the moon for no reason for 4 years, and he lost 4 years of his life. His father sent him the moon literally because he couldn't stand to look at him anymore after what his father did to him. His whole identity was tied to being his father's number one. He's known that that was all bullshit. And then the one person who made him feel wanted and seen, Allison, was accidentally hurt by Vanya. He probably feels guilty and believes he hurt Allison when he got laid when being high as a kite. Allison being hurt, a lot happened in those moments. Predominantly, he wanted to be the one to help her and he couldn't because of what his father did to him, which once added again to his feeling of inadequacy. And then you also have him realizing that Vanya, someone that he never saw as a threat, he now sees as a threat, whether it's justified or not, and he feels like he missed something, so he's being hyper-vigilant with what he perceives to be a threat, regardless of what everyone's telling him. God, it's just so much of this is Reggie's fault. So yes, he is still a monkey man who still needs to learn some empathy, but it can be argued that he was not in his right mind before everything went to I could rant about this dude for hours, but let's move on. I wanted to do questions for each of the characters. Question for Luther. Luther was strong before the accident and his father saved his life. We saw in the bank heist scene, he literally picks up a dude when he's like 13, throws him like a football out of a high window and basically kills the dude. And then now he's just bigger and stronger, I guess. So what, was he just Captain America strong before and now he's Hulk strong? Number two, Diego. Honestly, I really like Diego as a character. And it's probably because we handle our past traumas in the same way, being bitter as hell and wearing copious amounts of black. I've got way too much going on to be a vigilante, don't worry. My main complaint about Diego is that he seemed very the ends justifies the means, or in this case, throw a knife first and then step over and ignore all the red tape you slash through later. One example of this is when he's breaking into Leonard's house with Allison and Five. Logically, he must know that recon is best done when no one knows that you've been there, and yet rather than try and find another way into the house, he just straight up barrels through the front door window. Another example of this is his dynamic with Patch. Patch was a good character foil for him. Even though Patch and Diego had very similar goals, she had a completely different way of doing things. At least for me, based on what ends up happening later on in the season, it definitely seems like foreshadowing for how Diego was going to be framed for her murder. When they're together, she talks about how she knows what gets convictions and how if he touches something, she can't use it as evidence. And that's basically the same thing as what ends up incriminating him later on when he's trying to avenge her murder. Side note, I'm never a fan of killing a female character to advance a male character's plot. Just saying. Logically, he has to know that he needs to leave Cha-Cha and Hazel alive, at least for a little bit, to clear his name. And even then, it takes Five relating not killing them back to Catch for Diego to even think about taking the hint. And even then, he almost kills Cha-Cha. His relationship with Grace was very sweet, but also vaguely upsetting to me the entire time. After Vanya's line where she says, well, Dad made her and coded her to take care of us, do you ever look at her and just see an extension of Hargreaves? And then from then on, it was just really hard for me to like look at her as anything else than an extension of Hargreaves. Even though logically I knew that she had in fact evolved past it and she had already developed her own feelings towards the kids. The scene where Diego passed out from seeing the needle had me laughing on the floor. And the scenes where his stutter popped up when he was talking to or as bowed as mom had me crying on the floor. He was also one of the few characters to actually give Klaus the time of day, even if it was begrudgingly. My question for Diego, does his power work on all projectiles or just items that are knife-shaped? Because if it is just knife-shaped, then I anticipate him having one of these in his freezer and just whipping them out at random times for sneak attacks. I don't know, maybe it'd be his cool party trick. Number three, Allison. I have a lot of feelings about Allison and most of them are not negative, but a few of them are. Maybe this is just me, but the flashback where she uses a rumor on her daughter seemed very out of left field for me. In that, yes, her daughter was having a tantrum, but it was fairly mild and Allison really quickly pulled that rumor out and was way too calm about saying it to her daughter. To me, that shows that she had used her rumors on her daughter numerous times and was comfortable with doing it. Maybe this was just the first time that Patrick had caught her. If Patrick hadn't have caught her, would Allison have kept using her abilities on her daughter throughout her life? Also, that flashback takes place a year prior to the 8 days in which season one happens. And we know from when she's talking to Luther on episode one that Patrick filed for divorce 8 months prior to then, which means there's about a 4 month gap before Patrick filed for divorce. Did they try and work it out prior to him filing for divorce? And he realized that he was never going to be comfortable with the mother of his child using her abilities on their daughter? Or, and this is the bad one, that montage of Allison's rumors. The last one is, I heard a rumor that you love me. Could she have said that to Patrick the night he found out and it just postponed the divorce and then he realized, could that have been it? Because if that's it, that's really bad. I really hope that's not it. But she said it to someone at some point, which is also really bad. She's also complicit in that weird dynamic between her and Luther, but she's capable of showing compassion towards others. Even to Vanya, when she was locked up, even after Vanya accidentally almost killed her, because Allison knew it was an accident. So in this one, and in most other things, she wins over Luther. Also, I know this is really a Luther point, but I'm shoving it in here. I really wanted to like the phone booth scene where Luther is being Allison's voice to talk to her daughter because she can't talk to her and she knows there's a chance they're all gonna die. And it's literally him telling her daughter everything he wants to have the strength to tell her. And it's just really upsetting to me. I don't know. You can't be a good space boy and just have a legitimate conversation with your niece. It probably shouldn't bother me, but it does. Allison is really the only sibling who tries to be civil towards Vanya over the whole book thing. They have some really great scenes together, but it's also punctuated by these really weird but also fitting moments of Allison really not getting just how isolated Vanya was from them because of their father and how that really impacted her ability to read normal social cues and how that really impacted her trust in her siblings. The scene with the family meeting with Leonard where Vanya storms off could have been avoided how Allison just tried to call Vanya earlier or had even just in that that moment pulled Vanya aside and just said, look, can we talk? We can't talk with him here. Instead, she says, it's a family matter, while standing with all the other siblings, none of whom also tried to reach out to Vanya, while Vanya is standing with her boyfriend, the one person she thinks she has in her corner. Could have gone better. On a different note, Allison could have prevented the apocalypse had Luther just listened to her and not planned to ambush Vanya. She was getting through to Vanya. It would have gone fine. Out of all of the siblings, I truly think that Allison has like the scariest abilities. Like being strong, okay, cool. Go open a jar. You wanna go talk to the dead? Sorry. You can throw things with accuracy. So can a lot of fucking people who train really, really hard. She literally has the ability to fucking change someone's whole mind view and how they think and how they act. With one sentence, she made it so her sister completely forgot about having abilities. They're four in that scene. So let's say that they had abilities for a year or two prior to that. Even then, that's a lot. That's terrifying. I'm scared. Question, will she get her voice back in season two? Will they throw the rule book out the window and give her telepathy to make up for her loss of voice? Will she learn sign language and be able to control people that way? Wait, that's cool as hell. Actually, Netflix, hire me. Number four, Klaus. For the most part, I agree with everything that everyone is saying about Klaus, in that I too am outraged by how he was treated throughout the season. This boy was kidnapped and tortured, and his siblings did not notice. This boy went back in time, fought in a war, and lost the love of his life, and his didn't even get a hug. He literally died trying to help Luther, and Luther didn't notice because he was too busy getting high at a rave. He put on the performance of a lifetime in the doctor's office for five, and he didn't even get his $20. Is there no respect? No, but seriously, Klaus is a fairly great character, and he often gets the short end of the stick from his siblings because him and Ben share one brain cell, and Ben has had dibs since he died. But he is a barely functioning addict and needs some serious help. Him and Ben have a bickering relationship, but the way that Klaus always seems to make room for him to sit and puts out a cup of coffee for him and stuff is just really sweet. Also, the apocalypse was put into motion by Klaus. Let's face it, if he hadn't have thrown the book out so he could sell the box for drug money, Leiter never would have found it, never would have heard about Vanya's abilities. Vanya probably never would have had her abilities triggered. Apocalypse wouldn't have happened. Just saying. Hell, maybe instead, if he had opened the book and realized Vanya had had abilities, they could have helped her develop the abilities, and then Leonard could have off to Neverland somewhere. The apocalypse wouldn't have happened, at least not in the same way that it did, if Klaus had not thrown the book out. Just saying. We better get more flashbacks of Klaus and Dave in season two, or else I'm writing Netflix a strongly worded letter. Question. Apparently in the comic books, Klaus has telekinesis and can fly, but only when he isn't wearing shoes. Can Netflix Klaus get that? Because I feel like Netflix Klaus would probably fly into a wall at least once or twice, and I think that would be great. Number five. Five. First off, I am very proud of this fandom. I have not seen a single person trying to sexualize Five. Keep up the good work. It doesn't matter that mentally he is in his 50s. He is physically a small teenager. Go find someone else to call daddy. I need him to be nominated for several awards. I really believe that he was an annoyed old dude stuck in the body of a teenager in love with a mannequin and having a caffeine addiction. He needs all the awards. I really don't have any complaints about Five aside from the scene where he finds out that Klaus time traveled and he's like patting him on the back vaguely, and then he finds out that Klaus destroyed the briefcase, and then he's like not even concerned that his brother went back in time for 10 months alone. 10 months is a decent amount of time. Aside from that and the fact that he's in love with the top half of a mannequin, he's definitely the highest functioning Hargrave sibling. And honestly, the fact that one of his main motivations for this season was finding a good cup of coffee is honestly a mood. I don't drink, but I feel like if there ever was a time I was severely hammered, that like Five, I too would start proclaiming that I'm the four horsemen of the apocalypse and then immediately vomit. Question. I don't have a question for Five. I have a request. Don't give him a name. I like Five as a name. When he gets stuck in the future, he immediately calls out all their names, and when they're in the bank heist, they're referring to each other as names. Five was there. I think as a fandom, we're going with the theory that Grace named all the kids. I like the theory that Grace gave Five a name and he didn't like it and just said, I'll stick with Five. I like that. Number six, Ben. I have nothing to complain about. Ben is dead. It'd be a dick move for me to complain about him. He's not here to defend himself. I did feel really bad that he spent a majority of the season trying to get Klaus to either get sober or stay sober. That was really hard to watch. My main thing is, how did he die? Klaus sees ghosts as they died, as evidenced in the motel room scene where he's being interrogated by Hazel and Cha-Cha, and as he's sobering up, more and more of Hazel and Cha-Cha's victims start popping up, and we see how they all died, and they talk about it, and it's very clear that they're exhibiting how they died. Ben does not look like that. Ben's death is talked about like it was tragic, and yes, when someone dies young, that is always tragic. In the context of at least the Umbrella Academy universe, that implies that there was something dangerous that happened, like they were on a mission or or something. But Ben is in his street clothes. Like, he's in a hoodie and pants, whereas the uniform that Luther wears when he goes off on the mission that ends up almost killing him, he's wearing like a green type of suit. And then earlier on, all the kids are wearing their school uniforms to go on events. It probably didn't happen on a mission. I really want to know how Ben died. Did he sneak out? Did he storm off? His powers come from his belly. He has tentacles that come from his belly. Did the tentacles or something get severely injured and then he tried to like suck it back in so he could get help or stop the bleeding or something, but it was already too late and he died? So that's the only logical conclusion I can see, unless he was like poisoned or something. He doesn't seem to have anything physically identifying how he died. Just tell me how he died, damn it. Also, show us more fight scenes where he uses Klaus's energy to come out and use the tentacles, because that was really cool. I really like the tentacle fight scenes. They just look great. Question. I know the scene where they're supposed to be traveling back in time at the end of season one, they all kind of show a scene where they all look younger, and I'm fairly certain that may have just been for dramatic effect and to show how dangerous what they're doing actually is. However, Ben is dead. Would traveling back in time actually make him not be dead? Also, how far back are they going? Are they all gonna still be there? Was it just a couple of years? Was it before Ben died? Are they gonna try and stop Ben from dying? What are they gonna do? Number 7. Vanya. Nothing you do can convince me that Vanya is straight. She is at the very least a disaster bisexual like myself, and I hope her killing Leonard is the origin story for her getting a cute, not crazy girlfriend in season 2. My main complaint about Vanya is the book. Look, if one of my siblings wrote a tell-all book about me and my other super-powered siblings, detailing our powers, our weaknesses, airing out all of our dirty laundry, and making it very clear that our brother's death completely fractured our family, I'd be pissed. Yes, she was isolated from her siblings, but that really is her father's fault, and at least when they were kids, that's not on them. Yes, now they are adults. Whether or not they try to reconnect with Vanya the way Allison is trying to do is on them. I'm not gonna fault her in the scene with the family meeting when Leonard is there, because she was already riding high and excited and nervous about telling them about getting first chair, and Leonard had hyped her up and was saying, like, I'm with you, you're not alone this time. Already had placed the mentality in her head that it was us against them. There weren't a lot of ways that that scene could have ended without Vanya storming out. Needs a metric ton of therapy like the rest of them. I know they're going back in time, but I don't think Vanya's actions during her rampage were an entirely conscious thought. I think we need to be prepared for season 2 starting out with Vanya reacting to waking up in the past with her siblings the same way that someone being woken up from sleepwalking is going to react by lashing out. There's a very real chance she is going to hurt someone again, and that's how season 2 is going to start. The reality is that Vanya has a long way to go before she can start casually using her abilities the way her siblings grow up doing so. Question. The question is, why did you try and make me think that Vanya was straight? Hazel. Hazel and Agnes invented romance. Changed my mind. Cha-Cha. I'm bummed it looks like Cha-Cha got killed at the end of season 1. I didn't want her to have like a redemption arc or anything. I just kind of really like the idea of her just routinely trying to kill everyone. Maybe season 2 she's surprised, not dead, and then she gets a hot new partner who's just totally enthralled with her, but she's all about the job and murder. I want it. Pogo. To me it seemed like he had mixed motivations throughout this season 1, but I did like him and I was bummed that he got killed. Maybe we will get to see more if they do change the timeline. Reginald Hargreaves. A bad human thing and an even worse father. Collected kids for fame and to one day supposedly prevent the apocalypse, but didn't consider, oh I don't know, showing them any semblance of affection at any point in their life. Rather than try and help Vanya learn to control her abilities the way he did with the rest of her siblings, he locked her in a soundproof chamber for what looks like days or weeks, drugged her, had her sister make it so that she believed she was ordinary, and then routinely talked down to her for most of her life, and isolated her from her other siblings. Locked Klaus in a mausoleum for hours when he was 8 and probably more often throughout his childhood. Literally numbered his children like an asshole. I know I already did this one, but he made a 4-year-old complicit in making another 4-year-old think she didn't have abilities. Holy f***. Sent Luther to the moon on a fake mission to collect data and send back to him because he couldn't stand to look at him anymore. I could go on forever, he's trash. Honestly, I like the original plot that we were given of Grace actually killing him. Like, Grace had in fact evolved past her programming of what Hargreaves had done, and she became outraged and angry over the fact of how he had treated her children, so she took revenge by killing him. That would have been fantastic. Would have been swell. How do I get my adopted victims, I'm sorry, I mean children, under the same and roof, maybe prevent the apocalypse. After all the kids moved out, did he ever try to contact them to get them all under one roof? Luther was an easy one. Just call and bring him back, have Luther contact everyone. Did he ever even try that? Question, we never hear about the other kids born on October 1st, 1989. In the opening scenes of the first episode, it's implied that he went to numerous of the mothers who gave birth, and then he got the seventh. We never hear about any other people with powers. Had the other mothers already secretly put the children up for adoption prior to Hargreaves getting there? Did all the mothers mostly want to keep the babies? Did Hargreaves kill all the babies and the mothers? Answer me, Netflix! Alright, this video is already far too long. I'm gonna cut it there. I know a lot of this wasn't defending, and it was more just me gushing about certain characters and then complaining about others. This is what you get. You're welcome. Did you watch The Umbrella Academy? What did you think? What characters did you like? Were you one of those people slam dunking on Luther throughout the time? Did you read the comics? Is there anything you think that I left out that should have been included in any of these character thingies that I did? I don't know how I'm gonna title this. We'll see. Netflix, I need seasons 2 through 5 at your earliest convenience. Like, comment, subscribe, and all that good stuff. Follow me on all my social media. I'll put that all up here. That's it. Peace out. Rock on. Sleep tight. I was originally gonna rank the characters based on how many therapists I think they all needed, but then I realized I would be adding into the Trauma Olympics narrative, and I don't want to do that. So, Netflix, my pitch for season 2 is that all of the Hargreaves siblings each get a minimum of 3 therapists and a cookie.